happened during World War One, the policies, Wilson, us even being involved in World War One, how that is going to shape our economic and our domestic policy. So how do we shape what we do at home because of our isolationism, not wanting to participate on the world stage because of World War One? Okay, so that's what we're getting into over the next couple days. Okay, why is this doing this? I'm so sick of this computer. Okay, so during World War One, we know that we had Woodrow Wilson in power, right? Wilson is elected in 1912. He gets re-elected in 1916. And then after World War One decides he's stepping away, he is not going to run for a third term. Now, listen to me. Wilson was a what? Republican or Democrat?
Democrat.
He was a Democrat, remember? Because when he got elected in 1912, what had happened to the Republican Party? It had split, right? Who had split it off? Teddy Roosevelt, right? Because he wanted to take the Republican Party in a much more progressive direction. The Republican Party did not agree, so he split the Republican Party, making it very easy for Wilson as a Democrat to win the 1912 election, okay? So after Wilson is no longer in office, and when we have a presidential election in 1920, with Wilson being a Democrat and the Democratic Party essentially taking us into World War One, essentially, you know, they're the party that was passing the Sedition Act, how do you think that's going to affect who the American people want to vote for the next president? They don't want a Democrat, right? They want a Republican. Because in their mind, the Democrats drug them into World War One. The Democrats passed the Sedition Law. The Democrats violated their First Amendment rights, right? So they want to step away from the Democratic Party for a little while, okay? And so in 1920, a guy named Warren Harding, who was the former governor of Ohio, gets elected. Okay? And when Warren Harding gets elected from Ohio, when he goes to D.C. to become president, establish his cabinet, he brings all of his poker buddies with him. Okay? All his poker buddies, all his buddies that were his business associates from Ohio, he takes them to D.C. and they become his cabinet members. Who have we talked about before that did this?
Yeah.
The Kitty Cabinet, right? That was Jackson and his what system?
Spoil system.
Spoil system, right? How did the spoil system work out?
Not good.
Not good, right? Guess what? It don't work out this time either, okay? So Warren Harding's administration is a gold in controversy and scandal, okay? So one of his cabinet members, who is the director of the VA, what's the VA? Veterans Affairs, right? The Department of Veterans Affairs. It is their job to run hospitals and clinics and post-war care for our veterans, okay? So his director of the VA got caught. Now, what funds the VA? It's federally funded. Who's funding it? It's tax dollars, right? So essentially, your tax dollars were going to provide medical assistance to our veterans, okay? To our veterans and then those hospitals, the VA hospitals, okay? His director of the VA got caught stealing medical supplies from several VA hospitals in and around Virginia and selling those materials to private companies for money in his pocket. Exactly. So he's got caught stealing federally funded, tax dollar paid for medical supplies to the private market. So he gets in big trouble and he gets arrested. Okay? But the bigger scandal of Harding's administration is what was known as the Teapot Dome Scandal. You need to know this. The Teapot Dome Scandal. The Teapot Dome Scandal was the Watergate of the 1920s. This was huge. Okay? So his Secretary of the Interior, okay, if you're the Secretary of the Interior, what are you in charge of? Which is what? Federal land, okay? It's really interesting because nobody knows what the Department of Interior is, but it's the interior of the United States. So essentially, it's all of the land that the federal government owns. So essentially, they are in charge, especially of like the national park system. Yes. And so all of the land, especially that was like out west and still is out west today, that is federally owned, it is their job to maintain and oversee that, okay? So some of that federal land was in Teapot Dome, Wyoming. That's the name of the city, Teapot Dome, Wyoming. And in Teapot Dome, Wyoming, the federal government owned a bunch of oil reserves, okay? A bunch of oil reserves that we use, that the federal government used to run our Navy and our Army, okay? So there are all these oil reserves, thousands of acres of oil reserves in Wyoming the federal government owned. Again, we use that oil to supply our military, okay? So Albert Fall, who is his Secretary of the Interior, Albert Fall, gets caught leasing those oil reserves to private oil companies. And so these private oil companies would drive onto the federal land, drain the oil that belonged to the federal government, and drive off to sell to wherever they sold it to. And all that money was going in his pocket. He got in a lot of trouble. So he actually got arrested, convicted, and sent to prison. This was the first time we'd ever had a cabinet member get sent to prison for something that they did in office. Okay? So this was huge. This was a really big ordeal that he was selling or leasing land that belonged to the federal government to private corporations. It was a really big deal. Okay? They could say, I didn't know that thing belonged to the federal government. I would have bought it from the government. Okay? So, safe to say, Warren Harding does not get reelected. Okay? He is a one-term president. Okay? So in 1924, so they are known as the Ohio Gang, with their, like, spoil system, essentially. Okay? So, 1924 is the next presidential election, and the Republicans tell Harding, you're done. You're done. Go home. And they nominate a guy named Calvin Coolidge, okay? His campaign slogan was Stay Cool with Coolidge. That was literally his campaign slogan, okay? Would you vote for Stay Cool with Coolidge?
No.
All right. So here's the deal. Calvin Coolidge, being a Republican, still beat the Democrats. So what does that tell you? That even after the previous Republican was engulfed in controversy, the American people still elected another Republican. What does that tell you about the American people?
They really don't like the Democrat.
They really did not want a Democrat in office. Okay? So Calvin Coolidge gets elected. Okay? Calvin Coolidge is most well known for his Secretary of the Treasury, a guy named Andrew Mellon. Okay? And Andrew Mellon, they come into office and they start rolling out what they call supply-side economics. Okay? Another word for supply-side economics would be trickle-down economics. Okay? So trickle-down economics was not new with Ronald Reagan. This goes way back to the 1920s Republicans. And so what's going to be really cool that I hope you guys are going to start to pick up on is a lot of these policies that we're going to be talking about over the next several presidents, we're really getting into that part of American history where these historic policies associated with political parties, like we're really starting to get into like those formed policies and those formed ideologies that we still very much so have today, okay? So what we're going to look at today is talking about Andrew Mellon bringing up supply-side economics in 1924, almost 100 years ago, and how those policies are still very much so employed by the Republican Party today. We're going to look at the new tax cuts that have just rolled out for this year, okay? So I want everybody to put their pencils down to listen to me, okay? Because I need you to understand this economic policy trickle-down or supply-side economics, okay? So the idea behind supply-side economics or trickle-down economics, is that if you cut income taxes, if you cut the amount of taxes that people have to pay, what does that put in their pockets? More money, right? And what do people typically do if they have more money in their pockets? They spend it. They put it back into the economy, right? So supply-side and trickle-down also really heavily focus on cuts for the wealthy. Big tax cuts for the wealthy. How many of you have heard that, like, on the news and political rhetoric over the last couple of years? I mean, that is the political ideology of the Republican Party today. It's tax cuts, tax cuts, tax cuts, okay? So the belief is that if you cut taxes, either income taxes or corporate taxes, if you cut taxes for the wealthy, that gives them more money, right? So let's say, for example, let's use Port City Java, okay? So let's say Port City Java, the owner of Port City Java, they opened up their very first location in Southport. I don't know if that's true or not, but whatever. They opened their first store in Southport, okay? So let's say that year, the government rolls out with major corporate and income taxes for that business owner, okay? So if that business owner's taxes got cut by $20,000, what is the hope that he is going to do with that extra $20,000 if that Port City job has been successful? He's going to go open another one in Leland, okay? So that one gets going, right? And that one's really successful. And he still has more money in his pocket. Then what are we hoping he's going to do? Open another one in Ocean Isle Beach, right, or whatever, and so on and so forth. And every single time that business owner has the extra money and opens a new branch or a new location, what are they doing every time they open a new branch or a new location? Creating more jobs, right? So you have more jobs for people so that more people have consistent income, right? And so when more people have consistent income, what do those people do with their money that they have? Spend new shoes or go on vacation or buy a new car, buy a washing machine or whatever, right? So that is the hope of what we hope will happen, right? But what is the flaw with supply side and trickle down economics? You're hoping they'll open another branch or they're hoping they'll open another location, right? But what prevents them from buying a new vacation home in Sardinia or investing that extra $20,000 in the stock market, right? There's no guarantee it goes back into the economy, right? And especially when you talk about big time tax cuts, if you say you want to cut taxes by X amount, what also do you need to be cutting? You're cutting what's coming in, because that's what taxes are, right? It's money coming into the government. You're cutting what's coming in, you better be cutting that budget, right? Because what happens if you cut taxes by $500 million and you don't have that $500 million coming in, you need to cut the budget by the U.S. for the U.S. government by $500 million, right? But if you don't do that and you're still spending, but you're not making, what are you running? What is that called when you spend more than you make? The deficit, okay? So I want to show you guys, but during Calvin Coolidge's time, so that's why I want you to understand, is that supply side and trickle-down economics began way back with the 1920s Republicans. It was not Reagan, okay? So the taxes on the rich got cut from around 75% to 25%. It's a huge, massive cut for the wealthy during the 20s, okay? So that's what's going on economically, okay? So let's switch to foreign policy, okay? After we got back from this war, the United States wanted, and the American people wanted to have nothing to do with Europe, especially militarily, diplomatically, you know, whatever, politically. However, how are we very much so tied with Europe?
Trade.
With trade and economically, right? So can we truly be isolationists? We can't, right? And that's the risk you run when you create a global economy. And when everybody is very much so entangled and everybody trades with each other, what happens if one country collapses? It's a domino effect, right? And you have the ability to really tank everyone else around you, which is exactly what's going to happen tonight. Okay. And so the United States knows that we didn't sign the League of Nations, We did not sign the Treaty of Versailles. You know, we in no way, shape, or form wanted to be tied politically and diplomatically with those countries, but we know we've got to figure out something economically. And what was the state of Europe after World War I? Destroyed, right? Well, if they can't get their economy up and running and they can't get their factories pumping again, is that going to affect us? Absolutely. So we got to figure out a way how we can help Europe, okay? So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about three key pieces of legislation that get going during the 1920s that very much, so that's going to help me answer this question, shaping foreign and economic policy, okay? So the first one I want to talk about is the Dawes Plan, okay? So basically, what was one of the major parts that was of the Treaty of Versailles that was really going to affect Germany economically? The reparations, right? So we said that Germany owed the rest of Europe how much money? 6.6 billion pounds. Does Germany have the ability to pay that back? So what is that setting them up for? Right. And if they fail, if their economy fails, Britain's economy fails. France's economy fails. Our economy fails. Okay? And so we knew Britain and France were going to let her off the hook. And so what the United States devised was this idea of the Dawes Plan. Okay? And so what this does is we envision, and we did, if we loaned Germany $2.5 billion. Okay? Now, Germany needs money for what two things? What do they need money for? Huh? Reconstruction and like rebuilding their infrastructure? But they also need money for what? To pay back the Allies. Okay? So we decided we would loan Germany $2.5 billion. They would keep $500 million of that. And the other $2 billion they would use to pay back the Allies. Okay? Because if the Allies have money, what can be out? What can Britain and France and Italy be able to do? Well, by way of what? Trade, right? Because if they have that money, they can start rebuilding their factories and their infrastructure and their bridges and their roads, right? And if they get their factories and their bridges and their roads and their infrastructure up and going, then what can they do with us? Trade with us. Right? So if we invest in Germany, Germany pays off their reparations to the Allies and also reconstructs their country, they can get themselves up and running, we make money off of the trade. Okay, so it's a win-win situation for everybody. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah. Well, World War II happened, so no. It did not. Okay? But we did give Germany a lot of money. Okay. So, the next thing we're talking about has to do with foreign policy, okay? What was the one of the main causes of World War I? Okay, what else? Militarism, okay? What did we make Germany do with their military? Way demilitarized, okay? So, what the Five Power Treaty proposes is that it's an agreement between the United States, Britain, France, Italy, and Japan that all of these five major world powers would come together and they would limit the overall tonnage, the amount of ships that they had in their arsenal, okay? So this is a ratio. You don't need to necessarily understand the ratio, or like memorize, you should understand it, but you don't have to like memorize it. So the United States and Britain would have the same arsenal of ships, and then Japan, in comparison to Britain and France, would have the 5-to-3 ratio, and then France and Italy would have a 1.75-to-5 ratio with the United States. Okay? Who is glaringly, obviously, missing from this agreement?
Germany's
Well, Germany has no military, right? They got everything stripped down at the Treaty of Versailles. But who?
Russia.
1922, the Soviet Union is formed. And so the whole time this is going on, we are isolating Russia from these peace talks. Because, again, we did not observe Lenin as a legitimate government and the Bolsheviks as a legitimate government. So we did not incorporate them in any peace talks. They're just over in Russia getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Okay? So that's the five power treaty. So this is really, the big picture here is that this is an overall worldwide demilitarization. We really need to de-escalate our military. Yeah. If they take them over, then that's technically... Right. I don't know. Okay? Whose idea was this? This overall worldwide demilitarization? Whose idea was that? It was Wilson's idea. He talked about his 14 points, right? So I think it's interesting that you're employing Wilson's ideas, you know, under these administrations. Last one we're going to talk about is the Kellogg-Briand Pact. You guys want to get this closer tomorrow? It was just a bill to outlaw war. Saying we should not have war and that we should settle disputes diplomatically. What is ironic that the United States government is passing legislation saying we shouldn't have war. We should discuss things diplomatically and come together to hash out our issues. Why is that interesting? What already exists to do that we didn't want to be a part of? The League of Nations. The League of Nations already existed to do that, but we were like, no, we don't be a part of the League of Nations. But we want to hash out disputes diplomatically, peacefully. So we want our people to